Good afternoon, everyone. Can I remind all members that social distancing measures are in place in the chamber and that masks should be worn on entering and leaving or wandering about. And we now move to this afternoon's business. First item is portfolio questions, and the portfolio is health and sport. Question number one, Tom Arthur.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to reduce health inequalities.
Marie Goujon.
Reducing health inequalities is a clear priority for the Scottish Government and one of the biggest challenges that we face. Our programme for government in 2020 set out our commitment to promote lifelong health and wellbeing, and that included a renewed focus on tackling health inequalities. We're taking decisive action to address inequalities by making progress against our public health priorities and associated healthy living strategies, and our action plans on smoking, obesity, physical activity and alcohol and drug misuse, which were published in 2018. And we're also working closely with Public Health Scotland and other key partners to support and empower our communities to make the changes that are important to them. Ultimately, and right across government, we are also focusing efforts on addressing the underlying causes of health inequalities, such as ending poverty, promoting fair wages, and improving our physical and social environments. These are really complex issues, which is why our public health efforts are complemented by wide-ranging cross-government action. And reducing poverty and inequality sits at the heart of our investment across all portfolios.
I should have reminded everyone that if they wish to ask a supplementary, could you press your request to speak button or put R in the chat box if you're remote during the course of that question. Sorry to have held you up, Mr. Arthur. Tom Arthur.
Can I thank the Minister for her answer? The pandemic has exacerbated existing health inequalities, but it's also created new health inequalities with variations between regions depending on how successful they are at reducing the prevalence of the virus. As we move towards a level system, can the Minister assure Parliament that the Scottish Government will provide resources to those areas which need extra support in reducing prevalence of the virus?
Marie Goujon.
I would just say that I really share the member's concern about that, and especially that there are some groups of people that have been so adversely and disproportionately affected by COVID-19. The economic consequences of the pandemic are likely to have a negative long-term impact on health and exacerbate those inequalities that already existed. And as I stated in my first response, these are issues that we take extremely seriously. And that's why since the start of the pandemic, we've committed over £500 million of additional funding to support people and communities who've been impacted. And that includes over £140 million specifically to tackle issues like food security. That also includes the £50 million that had been announced by the First Minister in November for local authorities to support people who've been impacted by level 4 restrictions and guidance. And as well as that, though, and in addition to it, we've committed £479 million to local authorities of COVID consequential funding to really try and meet local needs and build that resilience. And as well as that, last week, we also announced a package of measures which was worth £37.2 million to tackle poverty and inequality. And that includes a further £100 million worth of a COVID hardship payment for qualifying low-income families. And that includes additional funding of £20 million for councils to tackle financial insecurity at a local level. And that means that almost £47 million has been made available for that priority.
Can I remind everyone that if answers and questions are very long, I won't be able to take supplementaries. Question number two, Shona Robson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what steps it's taking to measure and mitigate the effects of COVID-19 on child and adolescent mental health.
Claire Hawkey.
We have invested significantly in additional mental health support for children and young people during the pandemic. We also continue to monitor surveys, research and referral rates to provide us with an understanding of how children and young people are feeling during the coronavirus pandemic to ensure that the right help and support is available. In November, we announced an additional £15 million to respond to children and young people's mental health issues, building on our previous investment and commitments. Of this, £11.25 million is dedicated for services in response to the pandemic. The remaining £3.75 million will fund new and enhanced community mental health and wellbeing services for 5 to 24-year-olds. I know the member will have been pleased to see that £445,000 of this funding was allocated to Dundee to provide new services which focus on prevention, early intervention and the treatment of distress. In addition, last week we announced £120 million for a mental health recovery and renewal fund. The fund will ensure delivery of the mental health transition and recovery plan, including prioritising work to improve specialist CAM services, address long waiting times and improve other mental health supports and services for children and young people. We continue to prioritise support for mental health and wellbeing in schools and education through actions such as the Mental Health in Schools Working Group and Counselling in Schools. And we have also invested in a range of other measures to support young people, including digital resources in mental health and wellbeing available via Young Scots website and social media.
Shona Robson.
Can I thank the Minister for that comprehensive reply? Can she say a bit more about how CAM services will be supported during the recovery phase, particularly in relation to waiting times, how progress that has been made in response to the independent inquiry into Tayside Mental Health Services will be maintained, and whether the timing of the progress report, which was initially scheduled to take place this February, will be affected by the pandemic?
Claire Hawkey.
Our transition and recovery plan sets out a number of actions to progress improvement on access to CAMHS and psychological therapies. These include the implementation of our CAMHS service specification and provision of tailored improvement support for the 7 NHS boards with the longest waits. And this will help to clearly identify the challenges in these service areas and solutions to address unacceptably long waits. We're now working with mental health leads in these boards to support the development and implementation of local recovery plans by the end of March 2021 and target investment to improve access to CAMHS. Since the independent inquiry on mental health services in Tayside was published last year, I have been engaging closely with Tayside's executive leadership, who have prioritised improving mental health throughout the pandemic. And this is demonstrated by the fact that today Tayside have launched their mental health strategy, Living Life Well. And I'm pleased to see it has been endorsed by those with lived experience, service managers and others in the community. The implementation of the strategy is an important step in Tayside's improvement journey for mental health supports and services. The next significant step will be the outcome of Dr. David Strang's review of Tayside's progress, expected to begin in April this year. I wrote to Parliament's Health and Sport Committee on the 19th of October 2020 to explain that we had agreed to delay Dr. Strang's review to no later than April 2021. And this was to enable Dr. Strang to meaningfully engage with those with lived experience for whom using a digital medium is not always suitable. At that time, I assured the committee that Tayside's executive partnership
Minister. Thank you very much. Can I just say to the ministers, please, that I'm not even going to be able to get through all the questions with no supplementaries at this rate, so can we have shorter answers, please? Question number three, Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had the NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde and Inverclyde HSCP regarding either a replacement for or investment in Port Glasgow Health Centre.
Jean Freeman.
Port Glasgow Health Centre is one of NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde's priorities for investment in community infrastructure, but we have not had any proposals submitted as yet to Scottish Government. We will, of course, review any proposals which are submitted in due course.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for her reply, and I recently spoke with Jane Grant, the Chief Executive of the Health Board, regarding the Port Glasgow Health Centre, and I'm pleased that the discussions were very helpful. But does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that after building the £8 million Oxford View, Greenock and the new £20 million Greenock Health Centre is nearing completion, placement of the ageing of Port Glasgow Health Centre would provide my constituents truly first-class facility, in addition proving yet again the commitment of the SNP having for investment in health facilities in Inverclyde?
Jean Freeman.
I would agree with the member. I think the Scottish Government is committed not only to the health service and improving that in Inverclyde, but right across Scotland. We do that in the face, though, of a cut to our capital resource of 5% from the Westminster Government, within which we have a cut of 67% of financial transactions. So the envelope we are working within is significantly curtailed.
Question number four, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what it is doing to ensure that older patients in hospital are receiving the COVID-19 vaccine.
Jean Freeman.
The Chief Medical Officer issued a letter to all the health boards on the 5th of February this year, setting out the guidance on how health boards should vaccinate those within eligible JCVI priority cohorts who are in hospital prior to discharge in circumstances where that cohort is currently receiving vaccination in the community. Of course, care should be taken to check that records for previous history of COVID vaccination, confirmation of vaccine, and steps should be taken to enable a second dose as appropriate. All of those decisions are made quite rightly by clinicians, taking into account all of those factors.
Alexander Burnett.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? I have a constituent in their 80s who was recently transferred from NHS Highland to NHS Grampian, but they have not been vaccinated. But can the Cabinet Secretary clarify where the responsibility lies for this constituent to receive their vaccine and what measures are being taken to ensure that those transferring between health boards are not slipping through the cracks?
Jean Freeman.
So without knowing the particular circumstances of the individual Mr Burnett is referring to, I can't comment, nor should I, but if he cares to send me that information, as I've said many times in the Chamber and in the frequent letters to MSPs, I'm very happy to look at these situations. Chief Medical Officer and our Chief Operating Officer for the NHS have regular discussions both with the vaccination teams across the country and also with the Chief Execs to make sure that these policies are being implemented. But inevitably, there may be occasions where someone does fall through the cracks. As soon as we are alerted to that, we will take action to redress it.
Question number five, Alex Rowley.
Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what steps it's taken to address the reported increased demand for mental health services.
Claire Hawkey.
The Scottish Government are working closely with NHS boards to assess the impact of COVID-19 on mental health services in terms of both demand and capacity. And this includes anticipatory workforce planning, which boards are considering as part of their wider plans to remobilise services.
You caught me short there, Minister. Alex Rowley.
Thank the Minister for that answer. The latest government figures show almost a third of Scots are reporting high levels of psychological stress. We also saw the second Scottish COVID-19 mental health tracker study that revealed that suicidal thinking had been reported by 13.3% of respondents compared to 9.6% in the initial report in October. So I very much welcome the NHS Tayside announcement today, the Living Life Well strategy. Does the Minister accept that we need to actually develop those strategies right across Scotland? And will she be working with every health board to look at putting in place the support that's necessary?
Claire Hawkey.
I thank Alec Rowley for his supplementary question there, and he'll be aware that on the 16th of February, the Scottish Government announced £120 million for the Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund, and that fund will ensure the delivery of our Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan, including a programme of tailored work that will help individual boards respond effectively to the anticipated increase in demand in the months ahead. Mental health remains a priority for this government, and we will continue to work closely with both NHS boards and the third sector to ensure that people get the right help in the right place and the right support when they need it.
Supplementary, please, from Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much indeed. Can I ask the Minister how the additional funding of the £120 million she mentioned, announced by the Finance Secretary last week, will improve access to medical health services for those with pre-existing mental health conditions?
Claire Hawkey.
So the £120 million announced for the Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund will ensure that our mental health transition and recovery plan is delivered. And this covers all patients who are new to mental health services and those with existing mental health conditions. Alongside our tailored improvement support for NHS boards, the funding will support our ongoing work to improve specialist CAM services to address long waiting times and clear waiting list backlogs. And nearly £10 million of that will be allocated to clearing backlogs in psychological therapy waiting lists for adults.
And question number six, Finlay Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government how many new staff will be required to meet the mental health needs of people following the COVID-19 pandemic.
Claire Hawkey.
Our transition and recovery plan lays out the actions designed to support the mental health needs across Scotland, and it includes a commitment to develop a renewal programme for mental health services and undertake an assessment of future workforce needs. Additionally, we are working with NHS boards to assess the impact of COVID-19 on mental health services, and this includes anticipatory workforce planning, which boards are also considering as part of their wider plans to remobilise services. And this builds on our prior work in publishing the first integrated national health and social care workforce plan in the UK in December 2019. This sets out how health and social care services will meet growing demand to ensure the right numbers of staff with the right skills across health and social care services.
Finlay Carson.
Thank the Minister for that response. Bearing in mind the Royal College of Physicians and Psychiatrists in Scotland has already reported serious recruitment gaps in specialist mental health services prior to the pandemic, coupled with a recent poll suggesting over one in four people believe it will have a damaging effect on their mental health in the future, will the Minister pledge to provide the resources needed to address this through well-staffed services in both the short term and the long term?
Claire Hawkey.
Mental health is and will continue to be an absolute priority for this government. Last week, we announced £120 million for the Mental Health Recovery and Renewal Fund, and this is the single largest investment in mental health in the history of devolution. This is in addition to the £142.1 million that had already been allocated to mental health in the 2021-22 budget. Our Recovery and Renewal Fund will ensure the delivery of the mental health plan that we published in October last year. And this includes a commitment, as I previously mentioned, to undertake an assessment of future workforce needs as part of our renewal programme for mental health services. I can certainly provide the member with information about the additional recruitment that has been done under this government, and I'm more than happy to do that with him. And we will continue to work closely with the Royal College of Psychiatrists to discuss their concerns about the workforce across mental health services and to work closely with them in the Choose Psychiatry programme.
And a short supplementary, please, from Emma Harper.
To ask the government how it's working with the third sector in community mental health services, including across D&G, to provide greater access in local settings to signpost people to mental health services close to their communities.
Claire Hawkey.
The Scottish Government financially supports a wide range of third sector organisations that contribute to its improvement agenda for mental health and wellbeing. We know that the COVID-19 pandemic has had and will continue to have a substantial impact on the mental health of the population, and our transition and recovery plan recognises the role of the third sector in the delivery of our mental health ambitions. Specifically, we'll ensure that third sector organisations are among our core strategic partners for the development and implementation of the actions in the plan. And in light of the new challenges faced by third sector organisations, we'll continue to work in partnership with the sector at a strategic and operational level.
And question number seven, Tom Mason.
Thank you, To ask the Scottish Government what plans it has to reduce the backlog of elective surgical procedures has arisen in the NHS Grampian area due to the COVID-19 pandemic.
Jean Freeman.
Published figures for NHS Grampian at the 30th of September 2020 show 10,680 patients waiting over 12 weeks for surgical procedures. We are, of course, aware of these current pressures and anticipated them in response to the work against the COVID pandemic, which is why we published in November the Clinical Prioritisation Framework for Elective Care, which sets out the principles that NHS boards follow when considering decisions around prioritising cases on their elective care waiting list during the COVID-19 pandemic. At the same time, NHS Grampian, like other boards, is also in the process of completing its plan for 21-22 about restarting services as we successfully suppress the virus. These plans will seek to balance the need to address the backlog alongside the time and support needed by frontline staff to recover from the significant pressure that they have been working under for 12 months now.
Tom Mason.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. According to the latest data, in December, planned operations in NHS Grampian area stood at the second highest rate of any health board. This is in addition to procedures postponed since March last year, which number well into the thousands. We understand hospitals must prioritise treating coronavirus, but these are critical operations and effective cancellation on patients can be severe. So can the Cabinet Secretary assure me that NHS Grampian will have everything needed to get through the backlog, and when will my constituents again be seen within the statutory waiting times?
Jean Freeman.
So Mr Mason is absolutely right. These are critical questions and critical operations, not least for the individuals who are waiting to have them. That is the point of the prioritisation framework. It is an iterative exercise, clinically led, the framework itself clinically written, in order to ensure that patient status and the criticality of their operation is continually updated according to how they are progressing. That is also the point of the plans that I outlined there very briefly. They will come into Scottish Government at the end of this month, so by the start of next week. We will then be able to consider those and look at how we can continue to resource our health boards to return to non-COVID healthcare in an increasing way as we successfully combat the COVID pandemic. Of course, the one cannot happen without the other. And that is why the measures that we take as a government to continue to suppress the virus to its lowest possible level, all the restrictions that we ask the public to comply with, and they do, and we're very grateful for that, the vaccination programme, the testing programme, all of these are of a piece, and you cannot pick one out without also considering the other. As we make progress, I will, of course, be happy to update the member on NHS Grampian's particular approach.
And question number 8, Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of mental health services in rural areas.
Claire Hawkey.
Health boards were asked to submit plans which include mental health services as part of our NHS remobilisation process, and we've been working closely with all territorial boards, including those covering rural areas, throughout the pandemic to plan the recovery of services across Scotland. The needs of rural areas are taken into account both in our response to the pandemic and our plan for recovery. The Scottish Government acknowledges the difficulties some people can face accessing services in rural areas and is committed to providing clear, comprehensive and accessible support for mental health.
Colin Smith.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? Shocking new figures from the ONS on suicide reported that 133 agricultural workers across Britain, including 31 here in Scotland, took their lives in 2019. A recent study by the Farm Safety Foundation found that 88% of farmers under the age of 40 now rank poor mental health as the biggest hidden problem facing farmers today. Given that the pandemic and the measures to control it have exacerbated the problems of isolation and access to services in rural communities, does the Minister agree that we need better targeted mental health support, in particular focused on prevention and early identification of the risks associated with working in agriculture?
Claire Hawkey.
So I thank Colin Smith for that question. The needs of rural areas and their communities are taken into account in our response to the pandemic and our plan for recovery. And we've provided a range of funding to support mental health, including expansion of the NHS 24 Mental Health Hub phone lines, so it's now available 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. increasing capacity of the breathing space telephone and web support service, increased capacity for digital delivery, including computerised cognitive behavioural therapy, and expansion of the distress brief intervention programme so that anyone who phones the NHS 24 mental health hub in emotional distress from anywhere in Scotland and who doesn't need emergency clinical intervention and is assessed as appropriate for referral to DBI can be referred to the programme. And so far, over 2,000 people have been referred for DBI support via this pathway since it went live in spring 2020. The Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan, which I've referred to in previous answers, gives an outline of our continuing response to mental health impacts of COVID-19. And the plan recognises the challenges of rural isolation and includes an action to work with the National Rural Mental Health Forum to develop an approach to ensure that these communities have equal and timely access to mental health support and services, regardless of where they are in the country.
Can I have a short supplementary and answer, please, from Beatrice Wishart?
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Freedom of Information requests found that the 18-week target for CAMHS had been breached by a total of 1,316 days in Shetland in 2020-21. Staff are doing everything they can, but it's clear we need more boots on the ground to deal with this mental health crisis. What's being done to get more professionals in the pipeline in rural and island communities?
Claire Hawkey.
Thank Beatrice Wishart for her question, and I'm very familiar with the mental health services in Shetland, having visited them on a couple of occasions, and I commend them for the work that they've done there. Staffing under this SNP government in CAMHS has increased by 76%, but we also recognise that there has been an increase in demand and there has been an impact on waiting times due to COVID restrictions. However, services across Scotland are remobilising, and as I said in a previous answer, we are supporting boards who are having more difficulty and more challenges in tackling their waiting times. The £120 million that the Cabinet Secretary for Finance announced last week will help us to deliver our transition and recovery plan and to help us to tackle some of the backlogs that there are in those CAMHS services and ensure that young people get the service that they need.
Thank you, everyone. That concludes portfolio questions, and we'll move on to the next item of business.